رسول الله حبيب الله رسول الله حبيب الله الله our God is the greatest the one and only glory to him he born in humans to be the best and give his best religion to them Allah our God is the greatest the one and only glory to him he born in humans to be the best and give his best religion to him السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله وكفى وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى لا سيما المصطفى صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا All praise due to Allah alone, we all praise him and we seek his help. Whomsoever Allah guides is a truly guided one and whomsoever Allah leaves astray, no one can show him guidance. May the best peace and blessings be upon Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. Dear viewers everywhere, welcome to the 8th episode of Gardens of the Pious, a series which is designed to explain the beautiful collection of Riyad al-Salihin, a book which is compiled by the great Imam, al-Imam al-Nawawi. May Allah have mercy on him. In the first chapter, the book of al-Ikhlas wa-Niyya, sincerity and intention, today, inshallah, we resume with the seventh hadith. This hadith is narrated by a great companion whose name is Abu Hurairah radiyallahu anhu, Abd al-Rahman ibn Sakhr. He is one of the companions who narrated the greatest number of hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as I just mentioned that his name is Abd al-Rahman ibn Sakhr, but he was given this kunya, Abu Hurairah, and al-Hurairah is a minimization of a hirra, which is a little kitten, because he was a very soft-hearted companion. He used to carry normally a little kitten in his sleeve, so he was called the father of the little kitten because of that. He accepted Islam on the year of Al-Hudaybiyah, and inshallah we have to have a long talk about the biography of the great Imam and companion Abu Hurairah radiyallahu anhu. But now with the seventh hadith, which is narrated by Abu Hurairah. He said, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إن الله لا ينظر إلى أجسامكم ولا إلى صوركم ولكن ينظر إلى قلوبكم. And the hadith is collected by Imam Muslim. May Allah have mercy on him. This is a sound hadith. Again, إن الله لا ينظر إلى أجسادكم ولا إلى صوركم ولكن ينظر إلى قلوبكم. And the meaning of this short hadith, but great in meaning, is that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, most surely Allah does not look at your figures, at your bodies, at your looks, at your wealth, at your health. Rather, he looks at your hearts and deeds or accomplishment. Of course, we mean here with the word look, he does not look at your attire, the look of judging and evaluating the person. It is not because of how he looks like. So a person who's handsome will be treated better than a person who is not that fortunate. So he is not really a nice looking guy. Or a tall woman will be treated better than a short one. Or a healthy person will be evaluated greater than a person who's sick. Or a rich more than poor. No, not at all. These materialistic means do not mean anything when it comes to evaluating the person before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What really matters is the heart. وَلَكِ يَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ قُلُوبِكُمْ And the heart and the intention is insufficient. That has to be interpreted into actions. That's why he said, وَلَكِ يَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ قُلُوبِكُمْ وَأَعْمَالِكُمْ In Surah Al-Hujurat, In ayah number 13, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuhan nasu, inna khalaqnaakum min dhakarin wa untha, wa ja'alnaakum shu'uban wa qabaila lita'arafu, inna akramakum inda Allahi atqaakum. This is a very important ayah. Every person should measure himself according to this accurate, just scale. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in this ayah, and he's addressing all human beings, O mankind, we have created you from a single male and female, Adam and Eve. Then we made you into nations and tribes. Why? In order to get to know one another, know each other. Verily, إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ The most honorable one of you before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in front of Allah is أَتْقَاكُمْ The one who has more taqwa, righteousness. In the book of Riyadh al-Salihin, there is a whole chapter pertaining to taqwa. Inshallah, we'll be dealing with it, inshallah, in the future. But taqwa is to keep your duty to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to fulfill His commands, to abstain from whatever He prohibited. So one who sticks and adheres to the teachings of the Quran and the Sunnah, one who purifies his soul, and avoids doing anything that displeases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or incur his wrath and anger, is more righteous. إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ So the nearness of the servant to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be measured and evaluated according to the level of taqwa, the level of sincerity and good deeds, not according to the look, the richness, the health, or the position. Rather, it will be in proportion with taqwa. So one is not supposed to brag about his wealth, or a woman is not supposed to brag about her beauty, or about her husband's position, or job, or her dad's wealth, or education. Rather, a person should examine himself and decide whether he's really worth it or not based on the intention. And this is something, of course, the person himself, whether he or she can tell. Only the person and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what he concealed in his or her hearts. وَلَكِنْ يَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ قُلُوبِكُمْ So the hearts which determine whether the person deserves to be near to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or even if he's doing good deeds, but those good deeds were not our sincerity, then he is distant from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and accordingly from his mercy. Ali ibn Abi Talib, may Allah be pleased with him, narrated that. Once the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, while he was sitting, asked Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu. He was a great companion, also we'll get to know his biography, but he was a skinny and a short companion. He asked him to climb one of the trees to collect some of his fruits. So he did, right away. As he was climbing the tree, his shins, his legs were uncovered. Then all of a sudden, some of the companions started laughing. Others were smiling. Why? Because how skinny were his legs. He was so skinny and low. The Prophet ﷺ notes that. So he remarked saying, أَتَضْحَكُونَ مِنْ سَاقِي إِبْنِ أُمِّ عَبْدِ وَاللَّهِ By Allah, those skinny legs on the Day of Judgment will be heavier than the mountain of Uhud. Those of you who happen to go to Medina and see how long and extended is the mountain of Uhud and its width, it's a huge mountain. Has a lot of stories in the seerah, but this huge mountain will be outweighed by these skinny legs of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu. Why? Because these are not any legs. These are the legs of the great companion, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, one of the most righteous people. So he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what are you laughing at? Making fun of what? Of his skinny legs? They will be heavier in the scale of the good deeds, obviously, on the Day of Judgment, than the mountain of Uhud. Also, Anas ibn Malik, may Allah be pleased with him, narrated in another occasion that there was a companion from the Bedouins, from Ahlul Badiyah, by the name Zahir. He used to bring his goods to sell them in Al-Madinah. Al-Madinah was like the city for the Bedouins. And the Prophet ﷺ liked them a lot. So he used to visit the Prophet, give him gifts, and the Prophet ﷺ would exchange gifts with him and go out with him to give him a farewell, even though Zahir was described as damim. The word damim in English means ugly. I mean the look. But we cannot say that. Rather, he was not fortunate to be a nice-looking man. He was not a nice-looking man, but his heart was very pure, was full of sincerity. So one day, Zahir was selling his goods in the market. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam surprised him. He came from behind him, he hugged him, and he covered his eyes with his hands. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made fun with him. He said, "Who would like to buy this man? Who would like to buy this man?" He was joking. Look, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a very easy person, and he used to love to enjoy his time with his companions. So he was doing that with Zahir. Zahir wanted to know who is this, but the soft hands couldn't be but the hands of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he recognized him. He said, "Ya Rasulullah, nobody would ever buy me. I'm insignificant. No one would show interest in buying me. They would rather buy anything, but not me." He knew that because of his look, people were not even befriending him and so on. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "لكنك عند الله لست بكاسد." The word kasid means goods which nobody is interested to buy. They're sitting there forever. No one would even think of picking them up, even if it is for free. He said, "لكنك عند الله لست بكاسد." But before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you're not insignificant at all. Rather, you are very significant. A similar incident happened with another companion by the name Julaybib, that no one wanted to give him his daughter in marriage because he was poor and he was not a nice looking man. But he was righteous. The Prophet ﷺ said to him, "Go to such and such house, knock on their door, and say, the Prophet ﷺ sent me to marry your daughter." He went, and the daughter said, "Since the Prophet ﷺ recommended him, I agree." Even though the parents were reluctant because anybody else, but Julaybib is very poor. He doesn't have any qualifications, apparently. But the Prophet ﷺ knew that his heart was qualified enough for any Muslim woman to be her husband. Anyway, on one of the battles, the Prophet ﷺ on the Battle of Uhud checked out the martyrs, the shuhada, and said, "أتفقدون أحدا?" "Is there anybody who is missing?" They said, "Yes, so and so and so and so." They kept counting. And the Prophet ﷺ kept asking, "أتفقدون أحدا?" "Are you still missing anyone?" They said, "Oh, not anymore." They counted everybody. But they did not count one person whom the Prophet ﷺ remarked, saying, "ولكني أفقد أخي جليبيبة." "I'm missing somebody, my brother. I'm missing my brother جليبيبة. Where is he?" So they started looking for him, and they found him, that he has killed like 7 of the kuffar, and finally he was martyred. So the Prophet ﷺ buried him by himself, by his own blessed hands, and said, "جليبيب مني وأنا منه." Julaybib belongs to me, and I belong to him. Allahu Akbar. So basically, Allah is still in us. And similarly, the Prophet ﷺ, via his practice, over and over and over, it is not the nice look. Yeah, it's okay. It's nice to have a nice look, to dress nicely. But that would not determine your grade, your level, your degree before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Well, what will determine so is your heart. Again, so that lest some people will misunderstand me and think that nice looking people, and when you dress nice, this is a bad thing. Not at all. The Prophet ﷺ was the nicest, was the most handsome man. And he dressed up nicely. And he used to have a very nice outfit. He was paid for Jumu'ah and Eidain. And he would wear the greatest and the best attractive perfume and fragrance, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But all of that does not count when it comes to evaluating you or me or any person. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, فَلَا تُزَكُّوا أَنفُسَكُمْ هُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِمَنِ اتَّقَى. Don't you admire yourselves? Don't you praise yourselves? Because Allah knows best who is more righteous, who deserves to be admired. And the true admiration is admiration of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In Surah Al-Hujurat, and this is a great surah, do me a favor, brothers and sisters. If you have not memorized this surah, memorize it. And write down to me, send me an email, gardens@huda.tv. Tell me that, Alhamdulillah, I have memorized Surah Al-Hujurat. And now I pray by myself reading Surah Al-Hujurat, and I studied its meaning. I know the meaning of each and every ayah of this great surah. In ayah number 11, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا يَسْخَرْ قَوْمٌ مِّن قَوْمٍ عَسَىٰ أَن يَكُونُوا خَيْرًا مِّنْهُمْ وَلَا نِسَاءٌ مِّن نِسَاءٍ عَسَىٰ أَن يَكُنَّ خَيْرًا مِّنْهُمْ. What is the meaning of this ayah? This is not the entire ayah, of course. What the catch is in this segment. All you who believe, so he's addressing al-mu'mineen. All you who believe, la yaskhar qawmun min qawm. Let not any people mock at or scoff at or make fun of any other men. Why? Maybe the latter party is better than the former one. Yani if I make fun of somebody, you never know. Maybe this person whom I'm making fun of before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is better, is akram, is more noble, is more honorable, is more loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than me. So how could I make fun of somebody whom Allah loves more than me? Doesn't make any sense. وَلَا نِسَاءٌ مِّن نِسَاءٌ. Similarly, he emphasized and let not women or certain women make fun of other women. Why? Because it's also common amongst women. So that's why he emphasized that. Be very careful. This is a great sin. عَسَىٰ أَن يَكُنَّ خَيْرًا مِّنْهُنْ. It may be that the latter party, the party which you are making fun of, whether it's an individual or individuals or people or nation, okay? Maybe they're better than you before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what are you going to do about this? If Allah loves them more than you, what are you going to do about it? Subhanallah. Sometimes when we line up in the same prayer, and I reflect on this very oftenly, when the imam starts the prayer and says, Allahu Akbar, and the line has in some of the masajid 50, 60, 70 musalli in the same row. But subhanallah, you cannot find two people equal or equivalent. Each and every one has his own different grade. Why? We made the same wudu. We're praying towards the same qibla, we're offering the same fard, in the same masjid, behind the same imam, we're listening to the same recitation, but hearts are not the same. Hearts are not the same. Khushu' is not the same. Tranquility is not the same. Understanding, pondering, and reflecting upon the ayat is not the same. A person who's praying in halal clothes and outfit is not going to be treated like a person who bought his clothes from haram, or from riba, from cheating, from rishwa. We have to reflect on this. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah At-Tariq, إِنَّهُ عَلَىٰ رَجْعِهِ لَقَادِرٌ. Verily Allah is able to revive us and every person. يَوْمَ تُبْلَى السَّرَائِرُ. When will this happen? Resurrection. On the day where السَّرَائِرُ, the hidden and the concealed intentions, will be exposed, will be announced, especially of the ibadat, especially of the ibadat. We offer the ibadat, but we don't know whose ibadah is accepted and whose ibadah is not accepted. For instance, pertaining fasting, everybody abstains from eating and drinking, but a person who violates his fasting with backbiting, with watching whatever Allah has forbidden during that time of favor, Allah is rich enough not to accept his fasting, not even to consider this person was fasting. فَلَيْسَ لِلَّهِ حَاجَةٌ فِي أَنْ يَدَعَ طَعَامَهُ وَشَرَابَهُ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَنْ لَمْ يَدَعْ قَوْلَ الزُّورِ وَالْعَمَلَ بِهِ فَلَيْسَ لِلَّهِ حَاجَةٌ فِي أَنْ يَدَعَ طَعَامَهُ وشرابه. In this life of the in the world of this life, judgment will be according to outer part, according to how you present yourself, right? And this is very obvious. Sometimes you find an expert person, but he's not eloquent enough to express his experience. While another person is very talkative and he's less experienced, but in an interview, they will take the person who's more eloquent, can express himself, talkative, even if he doesn't have the qualifications which he brags about it. But in the hereafter is different. You don't have to talk to express yourself. Allah already knows whether you're qualified or not. That's why there is a very interesting hadith. I wanted to share it with you. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in this hadith, إِنَّكُمْ تَخْتَصِمُونَ إِلَيْهِ. You guys present your cases whenever there are two opponents or two people who are having a case, any dispute between them. You bring your cases before me. إِنَّكُمْ تَخْتَصِمُونَ إِلَيْهِ. وَلَعَلَّ بَعْضَكُمْ أَنْ يَكُونَ أَلْحَنُ فِي حُجَّتِهِ مِنْ بَعْضٍ. It may be that one of the two opponents is more eloquent than the other, knows how to present his case better than the other, while it is not his right, but he's more talkative. Okay, he's a good representative. وَأَقْضِي لَهُ عَلَى نَحْوِ مَا أَسْمَعُ. So I'm going to judge according to the case which I hear and I see. So be careful. If I judge for any person and I give him something which is not his right, I'm only giving him a piece of fire. So let him take it or leave it. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is warning us against what's very common today. Oh, I have this great lawyer. What does it mean? He can change the truth. He can make the criminal innocent and make the oppressed and the innocent criminal. Ala wa qawli zur. Ala wa qawli zur. This is one of the great sins, very destructive. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam warned against it repeatedly. That's why in the life of this world, a person may be oppressed and wrong. He can't take his right because he's not eloquent enough. Or he doesn't have the proof. He cannot show a document or a proof to prove his case. Before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is no need. Because on the day of judgment, يَوْمَ تَشْهَدُ عَلَيْهِمْ. On that day, the hands, the skin, the hearing, the tongue, the eyes, the body parts would bear witness against the person himself. Subhanallah. أَفَلَا يَعْلَمُ إِذَا بُعْثِرَ مَا فِي الْقُبُورِ وَحُصِّلَ مَا فِي الصُّدُورِ. In Surah Al-Adiyat, this is very important, in ayah number 9 and 8. أَفَلَا يَعْلَمُ إِذَا بُعْثِرَ مَا فِي الْقُبُورِ. Don't you know that the time will come where the graves will pour forth its contents. All the dead people will come out. Then they will be resurrected. Then what's next? وَحُصِّلَ مَا فِي الصُّدُورِ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will extract whatever was in the hearts. وَحُصِّلَ مَا فِي الصُّدُورِ. You have to prepare for this day. The following hadith is narrated by the great companion Abu Musa al-Ash'ari رضي الله عنه. And it is the 8th hadith. He said, قال سئل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عن الرجل يقاتل شجاعة ويقاتل حمية ويقاتل رياء أي ذلك في سبيل الله؟ فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من قاتل لتكون كلمة الله هي العليا فهو في سبيل الله. الحديث متفق عليه. And again, متفق عليه means it has been narrated by both Al-Bukhari and Muslim. May Allah have mercy on him. This is a highly profound hadith. Abu Musa al-Ash'ari questioned the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for verification. People go to wars, to the war zone. They sign up to join the military for various reasons. So Abu Musa al-Ash'ari asked and inquired about this. A man who goes to the battlefield, he fights bravely out of courage, out of courageousness. So people will say, oh, he's a hero. He watches too much Hollywood movies and he wants to be a hero. He wants to be labeled to get a pin, to get a nishan, to get a certificate that he's a hero. Some people even fight. It doesn't matter for them even if they get killed because they say, my wife and my kids will get a certificate that your dad was a hero. الرجل يقاتل شجاعة. The second case. ويقاتل حمية. حمية is out of prejudice. Out of nationalism. Out of tribalism. My people. So he's defending his people. He's fighting along with his people regardless whether they're right or wrong. He doesn't have a case. His case is, I am with them no matter what happens. ويقاتل رياء. And the third case is a man who's fighting to show off. To show off. He wants to show people that he is loyal to his country, he's patriotic, he's a hero or whatever. Whatever reason, there are many reasons. There's only one reason which will make this fight legitimate and will make this fight rewarded for. And if the person died in this condition, he'll be considered a shaheed. أي ذلك في سبيل الله. Which of these cases will be treated as this fight is for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم ignored deliberately the mention of the three cases which Abu Musa al-Ash'ari presented with الشجاعة وحمية ورياء. He did not address any of that. Then he said what? من قاتل لتكون كلمة الله هي العليا فهو في سبيل الله. Only whoever fights in order to make the word of Allah, the deen of Allah, superior and the most high, that is the only case which will be treated as في سبيل الله, for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In their fight, or in our fight against the Zionists, the Jews have occupied Muslim lands in Palestine. Now it's over 60 years. When the Arab started forming allies in the name of nationalism, Arabism, whatever, they failed once after another, several times. They were utterly defeated. Only when a group of Muslims fought in the name of Allah and they made takbir and they were eager to die for shahada, only at this time they were victorious. And they defeated these rumors about Israel and about the Zionism that they will not be defeated. They were defeated like a piece of cake. Why? Because when the slogan of Allah, Allahu Akbar, is released and announced, then Allah is the greatest. When you fight for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you do not oppress others, you will be supported by Allah. And who can afford to fight against Allah? إِن تَنْصُرُ اللَّهَ يَنْصُرْكُمْ وَيُثَبِّتْ أَقْدَامَكُمْ. If you support the deen of Allah, if you follow up the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you'll be eligible for the help, the support, and the victory which will be granted to you by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have a case in which a man asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulallah, أرأيت, what do you think? Have you seen if somebody attacked me and he said, give me your money. Shall I give him my money? Like somebody who sticks me up with a weapon. Give me your money. Shall I give him my money? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لا تعطيه مالك. Don't you give him your money. قال أرأيت إن قتلته. What if I kill him? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if you kill him, he will be in fire. He will be in an-nar. He said, Ya Rasulullah, what if he killed me? He said, you will be fi al-jannah. You will be in paradise. فَأَنْتَ فِي الْجَنَّةِ. In order to explain this equation properly, because some people may misunderstand this and throw themselves in harm's way, I would like to take a short break. Then inshallah, in a couple of minutes, we'll resume again. Stay tuned. رسول الله حبيب الله رسول الله حبيب الله. In a game of golf, both the caddy and the golfer have the same goal, to get the ball into the hole. Interest-free banking is similar.
With a clear view of the fairway, a predefined agreement without shifting targets, things should end up where you want them. Your deposits are safe, and your funds are ethically managed with a transparent and equitable approach to sharing risk and reward. No interest burden means more time to relax without the worry of nasty surprises. Rest assured, our interest is mutual. Jazz Bank, Nigeria's first full-fledged non-interest bank.
Have spilled over onto the
escalated into violent clashes between police and protesters
over the government's plan to avoid default.
And we're also hearing of injuries on both.
Journalist Charlie McGrath says the cuts will heap further suffering on ordinary people.
For decades, but the fence needs some repair.
This is a serious and big threat.
Join me as I explore issues. Pressing issues facing the Muslim world today. From the one-sided civil war in Syria to the genocide in Burma, from the Arab Spring to the elections in the US, and yes, even the Euro debt crisis in Greece. Honest reporting on a channel you can trust, and I won't leave an issue untouched. Don't miss the Ummah Tonight with me, Malik, on your favorite channel for the TV.
صلى الله عليه وسلم صلى الله على محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم صلى الله عليه وسلم
أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله.
I bear witness that none has the right to be worshipped except Allah, alone without partner. And I bear witness that Muhammad is his slave and messenger.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back. I would like to remind you with our phone numbers. The area code is 002-0238-555-248-249, and the email address is gardens@huda.tv. You can start ringing in if you have any inquiry or questions. I do have some questions which I hope to answer inshallah azzajal that I received on the email account of gardens@huda.tv inshallah azzajal. Also, do not forget, we made a promise, or at least a promise from one side, and I hope inshallah you agree with me, that I would like to get a confirmation that as many of you have memorized Surah Al-Hujurat and learned its meaning. It's not a very long surah. You can memorize it. It's easily memorized because it have many of the ayat which have been frequently repeated, and you often hear them in the prayer as well. Very beautiful teachings. I was talking about before the break about a hadith in which a man asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if somebody sticks me up, takes a weapon out at a point of a gun or a weapon, he wants to take my money away from me, what am I supposed to do? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, لا تعطيه مالك, don't you give him your money. He said, what if I kill him? You know, we fight, then I end up killing him. He said, he will be in fire. What if he overcomes me and he kills me? He said, فأنت في الجنة, he will be in paradise. The person should use his best judgment in cases like this. I'll give you an example. I remember many, many years ago, whenever I used to live in New York, and in the very beginning of my experience in New York, whenever I would go home late, they tell me that make sure you don't carry your salary, you don't carry any valuables with you in the train. I said, why? I said, because normally somebody will stick you up at a point of a weapon, a gun, a knife, or whatever. He will take your money away. So I said, okay, don't worry about it. I keep my money in the socks. They said, this is the first place they saw a session in. I said, okay, I'm not going to carry any money at all. They said, no, you have to carry some money, at least 20 bucks, 20, 40 bucks. I said, why? He said, because he may get mad at you. If you don't have any money, he will end up killing you. I said, is it that easy? People kill that easy? They don't understand how great is the sin of killing, and they kill for nothing, for 20 bucks? He said, this is how it is here. It is very unfortunate. When people have no respect nor fear to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they can do anything for the sake of their, you know, drugs they're taking, for the sake of whatever. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. In this case, if I believe I can overcome this person and I won't give him anything, yeah, do it. At least you can stop him from his oppression so that he will not hurt anybody else. You can turn him over to the authorities, to the police. But what if all what he wants from you is an insignificant thing and you are unarmed and the person is armed? So it is not equivalent. It is not a fair fight. You will end up getting shot. Here, 20 bucks, 40 bucks, it doesn't matter. You want my watch? Take it. Why? Because your life is much more valuable than that, and you still can make it up. So we have to comprehend this before, wanted to be a hero and end up paying the price for that, your life, of course. The following hadith is in the same line, which is the ninth hadith. This chapter of Al-Ikhlas wa Niyyah consists of 12 hadith in addition to ayat, which was studied, of course, beforehand. In the ninth hadith, which is narrated by the great companion Abu Bakrata Nufay' ibn al-Harith al-Thaqfi رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال إذا التقى المسلمان بسيفيهما فالقاتل والمقتول في النار فقلت يا رسول الله هذا القاتل فما بال المقتول قال إنه كان حريصا على قتل صاحبه متفق عليه. And by now we already know the meaning of the term متفق عليه, collected by both Al-Bukhari and Muslim. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said in this hadith, إذا التقى المسلمان بسيفيهما, whenever two Muslims are engaged in a combat or a fight against each other with their swords. Not necessarily with the swords, this is just an example. It could be pistols, guns, machine guns, swords, machetes, knives, hadira, an iron rod or a metal rod, anything that may kill. And when it's killed, both are doomed to fire, وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ. Both will end up in the fire of hell. فَهُمَا فِي النَّارِ. The companion Abu Bakrata al-Thaqafi رضي الله عنه said, Ya رسول الله, as to the one who kills the murderer, it is known and it's understood that he should be in fire because he's a murderer. But what about the slain one? Why would he end up in fire as well? The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, because he was eager to kill his opponent, the person who's fighting against him. You see, this is the prophetic reasoning. Sometimes when people fight, they become blind. They don't know, and this is, in most cases, it begins sometimes with a joke, sometimes due to fighting over an insignificant thing. So they end up fighting, one of them would take a weapon or a sharp tool, would stab the other one, you get killed, and the family will take revenge, and an endless series of killing and bloodshed, and this is the worst. لزوال الدنيا، لزوال الدنيا. The removal of the whole world is easier than shedding the blood of an innocent Muslim. This is how bad it is. The demolition of the Kaaba is easier, even though this is the greatest, but it's still easier than shedding the blood of a single Muslim. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said in a hadith which is collected by Tirmidhi and narrated by Abu Huraira رضي الله عنه, من أشار على أخيه بحديدة لعنته الملائكة. Consider this is a sharp tool. A knife, an iron rod, a metal rod, or even a pen which may poke somebody's eye or kill him. When you point to your brother's face or body with this sharp tool, لعنته الملائكة, the angels will keep cursing him حتى يدع, until he drops it. Can you afford to be cursed by الملائكة? Why? Because الشيطان may push your hand, may cause you at a moment of anger to kill an innocent person, to kill your brother. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, if two Muslims fight against each other, التقى المسلمان بسيفيهما, with two swords, with two knives, whatever, anything that kills, boomstick, فالقاتل والمقتول في النار, then both are doomed to hell. When they asked him, what about the murdered one? He's innocent. He has been killed. Yeah, but if he was not killed, he too was very keen to kill his opponent. And here is the catch in the hadith. And that's why Imam al-Nawawi listed this hadith in the chapter of sincerity and an-niyyah, intention. His intention was enough to make him doomed to hell. Why? Because even though he got killed, but he was very keen to kill his opponent. وَالْعَيَدُ بِاللَّهِ. In the other hadith, عند ابن حبان, the same hadith but with another addition, which is وَإِنْ كَانَ أَخَاهُ لِأَبِيهِ وَأُمِّهِ. Even if the two opponents are brothers, blood brothers, if a brother is pointing with a sharp tool to his brother, لعنته الملائكة. I know, I'm just joking, I'm kidding. He's my brother, I won't kill him. I'm just joking, I'm threatening. Even if he was your brother, blood brother, الأخ الشقيق لأبيه وأمه, لعنته الملائكة, until he drops this weapon and says, أستغفر الله العظيم. وإما ينزغنك من الشيطان نزغ فاستعذ بالله إنه هو السميع العليم. سورة فصلت. نعم. In Surah النساء, in ayah number 93, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ يَقْتُلْ مُؤْمِنًا مُتَعَمِّدًا فَجَزَاؤُهُ جَهَنَّمُ خَالِدًا فِيهَا وَغَضِبَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَلَعَنَهُ وَأَعَدَّ لَهُ عَذَابًا عَظِيمًا. Who can afford that? This is the worst dilemma. That is the worst thing that may happen to any person. Whoever kills a believer deliberately, then his punishment will be جهنم خالدا فيها, to reside eternally in the fire of hell. وغضب الله عليه, and Allah is angry with him. Allah's wrath will be upon him. ولعنه, and Allah curses him. وأعد له عذابا عظيما, and he has prepared for him above all a very severe torment. معاذ الله. Why? Muslims are killing Muslims. Muslims are killing Muslims. It is very obvious that those who are killing those innocent people anywhere would end up having this terrible fate and develop eternally in fire. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. No one can afford that. So we have to avoid the means because they're very slippery. A person who is carrying a tool, a sharp tool, or in a fight, and he loses his temper, and he gets angry, and he kills another person, that's it. It's over. كل ذنب عسى الله أن يغفره. Any sin, Allah may forgive it, except a person who died as a believer, or a person who has shed an innocent blood. والعياذ بالله. من قتل دون ماله فهو شهيد, ومن قتل دون عرضه فهو شهيد, ومن قتل دون أهله فهو شهيد. What does it mean? A person who dies while defending his honor, his family, his wealth, his home, is a shaheed. This is in line with the previous hadith which we mentioned. So now if somebody breaks in, sticks you up and says, give me your money. And he wants to take your daughter, or your wife, or whatever. You defend them. No way. On my dead body. So you get killed. This is a shahada. Equivalent to dying for the sake of Allah on the battlefield. This is a statement that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made. Defending your possessions, defending your wealth, because it's your property. And the other person is a transgressor. So if you kill him, then he will be finnar. And he kills you, if he kills you, and he overcomes you, then فَأَنْتَ فِي الْجَنَّةِ وَأَنْتَ شَهِيدٌ as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. I hope we have time to finish the 10th hadith. But it seems like we only have 3 minutes to go. So I would rather answer this question which I received from Tariq Nisar Ahmed. Is asking about sujood al-tilawa and which dua to be recited in it. Its hukm and how to do it. Sujood al-tilawa is a prostration upon reciting an ayah which has sajda, such as wasjud waqtarib. Wasjud waqtarib means prostrate yourself and draw nearer. You will find on top of the word usjud, a command of making sujood, a short line. This is an indication that you should make sujood here. Its hukm, al-ulama have different opinion in that. The vast majority of the scholars are of the view that it's a sunnah. While al-imam Abu Hanifa and his school of thought believe that sujood al-tilawa is a must. Why the vast majority of the scholars believe that it's a sunnah and it's not a wajib like what Abu Hanifa believes in? Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did it sometimes and he skipped it deliberately sometimes. And at-tarku, or not doing anything, indicates that it is not a must. It is not a wajib. Umar ibn Khattab radiyallahu anhu narrated that. He said, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ إِنَّمَا نَمُرُّ بِالسُّجُودِ فَمَنْ سَجَدَ فَقَدْ أَصَابُ وَمَنْ تَرَكَ فَلَا إِثْمَ عَلَيْهِ. And this hadith is collected by Imam al-Bukhari. He said, we pass by آيات السجود, 15 or 16 ayahs in the Quran. In one surah there are two positions in Surah Al-Hajj. Otherwise, the ayat scattered all over the Quran from Surah Al-A'raf and so on till Surah Al-Alaq. So he said, we pass by this ayat. Whoever wants to make sujood, فَقَدْ أَصَاب. He did very well. And whoever leaves that sujood and does not do it, فَلَا إِثْمَ عَلَيْهِ. He is not committing any sin. So what do we say in this sujood? Similar to what we say in the regular sujood, and you can also say سُبُّوحٌ قُدُّوسٌ رَبُّ الْمَلَائِكَةِ وَالرُّوحِ اللَّهُمَّ لَكَ سَجَدْ وَبِكَ آمَنْتُ وَلَكَ أَسْلَمْ سَجَدَ وَجْهِ لِلَّذِي خَلَقَهُ وَصَوَّرَهُ وَشَقَّ لَهُ سَمَعَهُ وَبَصَرَهُ تَبَارَكَ اللَّهُ أَحْسَنُ الْخَالِقِينَ. Also you may say, اللهم احطط عني بها وزرا واكتب لي بها أجرا واجعلها لي عندك زخرا. وضوء or not wudu. Is the tahara required for sujood al-tilawa? Based on their understanding whether this sujood is a salah or not, there is a difference of opinion. And those who believe it is not a salah do not require wudu. For instance, Abdullah ibn Umar radiyallahu anhuma used to perform sujood al-tilawa without wudu. And that gives us ease. And this hadith is collected by Imam Bukhari because this sajda is not a salah. It does not require taslim for innocence after you finish the sujood, and it is only one sajda, brothers and sisters. By that we come to the end of today's edition of Guardians of the Pious. Until next time, I leave you in the care of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَقُولُ قَوْلِي هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَى نَبِيِّنَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ وَسَلَّمْ وَالسَّلَامُ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ وَبَرَكَاتُهُ. رسول الله حبيب الله رسول الله
حبيب الله. Allah, our God is the greatest, the one and only glory to Him. He born in humans to be the best and give His best religion to them. Allah, our God is the greatest, the one and only glory to Him. He born in humans to be the best and give His best religion to them.
So why did they ignore that? Forgetting all about it in paradise, worshipping cows, fire and stones, selling the best with the cheapest price.
So why did they ignore that? Forgetting all about hell and paradise, worshipping cows, fire and stones,